This video was made possible with the brand new Corsair Scimitar RGB Elite. With a whopping 17 programmable buttons and the patented key slider control system, you'll finally be able to keybind all of your favorite emotes. Get yours today with code MizTech for 10% off at Corsair.com. Hi everyone, welcome to the visual guide for Eden's Verse Refulgent Savage. This is the final new Savage raid made available by patch 5.2 in Final Fantasy XIV, Echoes of a Fallen Star. Please note that the perfect strategies are still being optimized for this fight and may change over time. Since this encounter is incredibly complex, I'll be splitting this guide into two videos. This first part will cover Phase 1 and the Ad Phase. If you're looking for the post-Ad Phase guide, be sure to click on the link in the description below. My name is MizTech and I'll be your raid guide. We begin by pulling the boss into the center of the platform. Absolute Zero is a very heavy-hitting raid-wide blast. Be sure to mitigate and heal through this appropriately. The first Mirror cast will spawn three mirrors on the north, east, and west edges of the platform. There are two green mirrors and one red mirror, with the red mirror always being either east or west. These mirrors will reflect the next attack the boss casts. Green mirrors will always reflect first, with the red mirror reflecting after a bit of a delay. Next, the boss will cast either Biting Frost or Driving Frost. Biting Frost is a 270-degree frontal attack that players will need to be directly behind her to avoid. Driving Frost is essentially the opposite of that other attack, targeting 90 degrees directly behind her. Players will need to be in front or to her sides to avoid this attack. This first cast is always random, so be ready to adjust accordingly. Depending on which attack the boss uses, the mirror reflections will form very specific safe zones either in the north or the south edges of the platform. For Biting Frost, players will move to the southern edge, on the side with the red mirror. Make sure you're right against the edge, as the reflected attacks are incredibly wide. After the green mirror reflections, players will move to the opposite side to dodge the red mirror. For Driving Frost, players will move to the northern edge, on the side between both green mirrors. After the first reflection goes off, players will move to the opposite side to dodge the red mirror. Once mirrors reflect an attack, they will despawn and the boss can be returned to the center. Shiva will then jump into the exact center and cast Diamond Frost, dealing high raid-wide damage. Healers be ready. One tank and one healer will be afflicted with a freezing debuff. If this debuff is not dispelled, the player will be completely frozen for 5 seconds. In this phase, healers should be ready to dispel these debuffs as soon as possible. Immediately after, one tank, one healer, and two damage dealers will be targeted for circle AoEs, and two large AoE circles will form in either the north and south or the east and west of the platform. These ground circles will then spread to either side until they get all the way around the platform. The players with the targeted circle AoEs will soon get hit with ice, dealing damage and afflicting them with heavy. This heavy cannot be dispelled and will persist for some time. Immediately after, in the location of each of these ice explosions, star AoE markers will appear that will soon shoot out long line attacks in the direction of each arrow on the marker. At the same time, the tank and healer that were originally debuffed with freezing will be targeted for flare markers that need to be separated from each other. The boss will then cast Heavenly Strike and knock back all players away from the center. As soon as the knockback resolves, the two damage dealers who have not been targeted by anything so far will be targeted by three AoE circles in a row. That is an insane number of mechanics all at once, so let's break it down. As soon as Diamond Frost casts, the healers will need to Asuna the two freezing debuffs. The four players targeted by the AoE circles will move to their assigned positions to drop off their snow and incoming star markers. Using the inner circle as a reference point, we assign two players to each intercardinal point on the circle to avoid overlap and control the incoming star blast pattern. Any players unaffected by markers can move directly underneath the boss to avoid getting hit. While this is happening, the unaffected tank and healer will identify where the AoE circles are spawning on the edges and prepare to spread into those directions. With the timing of everything, all players will want to pre-position themselves to be knocked backwards towards where the outer edge AoEs have spawned. By the time the knockback happens, these will be the safe spots available to avoid the attacks completely. To avoid confusion, we have the flare tank get knocked towards the west or the north, while the flare healer gets knocked towards the east or the south, depending on which variation spawns. As soon as the ice explodes on the four players on the intercardinals, they'll need to pre-position for the knockback as well. Since the heavy debuff they have is very significant, they won't have much time to do so. All players will wait on the edge of the boss's hitbox, get knocked backwards, and then wait for the starburst AoEs to explode. Be careful not to move back into the middle of the platform too early, or you will probably die. As soon as the starburst AoEs explode, the damage dealers targeted for the three AoE circles will need to move away from the group to keep the circles from obstructing the rest of the group. At this point, the boss will again cast either Biting or Driving Frost. This cast will always be the opposite of whatever the very first cast was, and armed with this knowledge, you can pre-position the boss to minimize raid movement. The main tank will keep the boss on the edge and face her in or outwards depending on what attack is incoming, to ensure that the center of the platform is always safe. Next up, the boss will cast Double Slap. This is a heavy-hitting tank buster that applies a physical vulnerability up debuff, cooldown appropriately, and tank swap. Immediately after, the boss will emote, begin to glow, and change her clothes. This is a gaze attack that will stun any players looking at her at this time. Since there's no visual indicator apart from the glow, players can easily learn the timing based on her voice line. Once you hear the word peace, you'll need to look away. Next up, the boss will cast either Scythe Kick or Axe Kick. Scythe Kick is a large donut attack. Players will need to be at max range or inside melee to avoid it. Axe Kick is a large point-blank AoE attack. All players will need to move to max range to avoid. Soon after, the boss will jump to the center and cast Light Rampant. This is another combo of mechanics with a million things happening at once. All players will be afflicted with a light steep debuff, ranging from no debuff at all to up to 2 stacks of the debuff. This debuff will explode for incredibly high damage if you reach 5 stacks. In this mini phase, each hit from a mechanic will add 1 stack to your light steeped. The goal is to resolve all the incoming mechanics without any player getting more than 4 stacks of the debuff, or you will die. One tank, one healer, and 2 damage dealers will also be chained to each other with 2 sets of chains. One set of chains will explode if you move too far, while the other set explodes if you're too close. 4 single player soak towers will also spawn at the intercardinals around the boss, and the other tank, healer, and 2 damage dealers will be tethered to orbs that spawn around the platform. These orbs will decrease in size over time, and getting hit by your orb will deal damage proportional to the size of the orb at the time. Or players will have to kite their orbs around until they reduce in size twice before absorbing them. There are a few ways to deal with this combo of mechanics. In this video, I'll be going over the first strat our group used. While this strat is safer, melee uptime will take a hit. I'll be doing a dedicated video for the uptime strat for Lights Rampant at a later time, but for now, let's see how we handle everything at once in a relatively easy way. The 4 players chained together will each soak the first round of towers. The second round of towers will eventually reform as 2 in the north and south. To ensure that the chains never get too close or too far during this adjustment, players will need to form an hourglass shape during the first set of towers. To achieve this, we assign the chain healer to the northwest tower, the chain tank to the northeast tower, and have the 2 damage dealers float between the southwest and southeast towers. If the chains form a square, the 2 damage dealers will know to swap position between the 2 southern towers. At the same time, the 4 unchained players will each become tethered to an orb. These orbs spawn at the cardinals. Each tethered player will immediately need to reposition themselves to the cardinal clockwise of their orb spawn. During this time, the 4 closest players will be targeted for path of light cleaves. Since this happens to be the 4 players in the towers, these cones will be directed towards each intercardinal point, naturally ensuring that there is no overlap. The orb players can easily avoid getting hit by these conal attacks in their position at the cardinal clockwise from their orb spawn. As soon as that conal attack resolves, the orb players can continue clockwise to the next intercardinal point before moving back into the center. Be careful if you need to drag an orb past a soak tower with players in it, as you don't want it to be accidentally popped. Back at the towers, as soon as that conal attack goes off, the first round of towers also resolves and 2 soak towers will reform in the north and south. These towers each require 2 players inside of them to appropriate soak. To handle this soak without disagreeing with any of their chains, the chained players will need to move into the direction of the player next to them that they are currently not tethered to, until they both meet inside the new tower. The movement here can be quite finicky, so make sure you're not moving too far or too close while you move to enter into the towers. The second tower soak will resolve at this time and the chains will disappear. A final soak tower will spawn directly underneath the boss that will require 4 players to satisfy. At this time, the previously chained players will move out of melee range to allow all the orb players to come in and be the 4 closest players to the boss. This will cause the next round of Path of Light conal attacks to target them. The orb players can also pop their orbs safely during this time. At this point, with most of the mechanics resolved, 4 players will have 3 stacks of the light steep debuff, while the rest all have 4, making them ineligible to deal with any other mechanics. The players with 3 stacks will all have to move into the final soak tower. This final tower soak marks the end of the light rampant phase, and the light steep debuffs will naturally fall off players.
mirrors. The boss will then cast Mirror Mirror, this time spawning 4 green mirrors at each cardinal point around the edge. She will then cast Axe Kick or Scythe Kick, the opposite attack of what she cast originally earlier in the phase. If she's casting Axe Kick, all players will first need to move out of melee range. Then, they'll need to immediately move back into the center of the platform to avoid the reflected attacks from each mirror. At the same time, Banish will target the 4 damage dealers with stack up markers. This attack can be tricky, and all players will need to pay attention to the orbs floating around her head during the cast. If you see one orb, the attack is real, and players will need to stack with their partner in assigned positions. If you see 4 orbs, the attack is divided or fake, and players will instead need to spread apart. To avoid overlap here, we assign positions for everyone to spread to around the boss. If she's casting Scythe Kick, all players will first need to stand within her hitbox. As soon as the kick goes off, each player pair will move to the mirror at their assigned spot for the reflected attack. During this time, Banish will mark up the 4 damage dealers with stack up markers. Players will need to look at the orbs again around the boss's head to determine if this attack is real or not. Again, one orb means it's a real stack, and players will have to stick together to share the damage. If you see 4 orbs, it's fake, and players will need to spread apart to avoid overlap. To keep on track with the Titan Enrage timer, players should aim to have Shiva down to about 69 or 70% here. The lower the better. At this point, Shiva will fly away and begin to cast Shattered World. This will divide the platform into 2 circles and transition the fight into the ad phase. The group will need to split in half here, as the circle you're standing in will determine which platform you are sent to in the ad phase. In this phase, different ads will spawn in 4 waves that will slowly make their way to the crystal in the center. Each ad that reaches the center will add 25 to the Flood of Light gauge. Should this gauge reach 100, you will die. If you end this phase with 0 gauge, you will be rewarded with a slight damage up buff for the beginning of the next phase. With each round, the crystal will explode, dealing high damage and spawning adds. Electric Aether adds will reflect back a set amount of damage for each hit that they take. Players will need to be careful not to hit these too quickly to avoid excessive damage. The Earth and Aether adds will cast Stone Skin once they spawn. This cast must be interrupted to ensure that you can kill them before they reach the center. The Aqueous Aether adds have a much higher health pool and are stunnable. Players can use stuns to slow down its advancement while they burn it down. Lastly, a glowing, motionless ad will spawn that will tether to the crystal. This tether must be intercepted by a player to avoid building the gauge meter. The tether will deal damage and afflict the player with light resistance down debuff in a small area around them, meaning they won't be able to take any more tethers until their debuff falls off. To handle this, players will need to assign a player to each tether ad in each round. Other players must stay away from this area to avoid getting hit by splash damage and an accidental debuff. Each side has their own order of adds per round, and players will have to learn how to handle each round effectively. On the left side, players will deal with 1 Aqueous, 2 Electric, and 1 Tether add in the first round, 1 Earthen and 1 Tether in the second round, 1 Aqueous, 1 Earthen, and 1 Tether in the third round, and finally 2 Electric and 1 Tether add in the fourth round. On the right side, players will deal with 1 Earthen, 1 Aqueous, and 1 Tether add in the first round, 2 Electric and 1 Tether add in the second round, 2 Electric, 1 Aqueous, and 1 Tether add in the third round, and finally 1 Earthen and 1 Tether add in the fourth round. Once all 4 ad rounds complete, players will be returned to the main platform and a lengthy cutscene will play before the final phase begins. If you have any questions or comments, please let me know. This guide will continue in part 2. As always, thanks for watching. Till next time.